As the intro just stated, this is the first in a series of auto extrication videos. This one will focus mostly on the first minute or two on scene, stabilization and de-energizing the car. But later videos will be more technical and more evolved techniques. What's important to remember is these are all going to be tools for your toolbox. Techniques you learn in this video and later videos can be applied to what you know now, what you may learn in the future. No one way is going to work on every car, and it may take multiple techniques to extricate the patient. And as car manufacturers increase their safety for passengers, there'll be new techniques to add to all that as well. What I want to emphasize in the first few videos though is to become proficient with your cutters and spreaders and other extrication tools. Know that as your spreaders spread open, the angle that they'll be at the end, because that'll adjust your bite at the beginning. Know that as you compress your cutters into the metal, they're going to twist. So adjust your grip a little bit one way or the other. Those little things in becoming more proficient with your tools will make you better in the more evolved extrication techniques later down the road, like displacing the dash or something really cool like cracking the egg. We're gonna go back now to the basics. We're gonna talk about scene safety and size up and de-energizing the car.
So what we need to do now is we need to approach this vehicle from a safe 45 degree angle, and we need to go and make sure that it is stable with our primary stabilization, which would be our step chocks. We're going to place our step chock on the lower part of the A-post, placing it upside down just like Lieutenant Haley just showed you. We now need to take the 4x4 cribbing, place it in front of the rear tire to lock that suspension in from rolling backward and forward. Now, Lieutenant Haley is going to go inside to make sure the vehicle is in park. Once we've secured it's in park, we're going to take the keys. We're going to remove the keys from the vehicle, placing them onto the hood and placing the hazard lights on inside the vehicle to let us know that the vehicle battery is still intact and still electrically charged. Your next objective is to do a check of the hood to make sure that the latch either works or doesn't work to pop that, so we can get access to the 12-volt system. Now that we've made sure that the vehicle is secured and the hood is not opening, we're gonna go ahead and complete the 360 around to the passenger side of the vehicle. We're looking for bodies, down power lines, electrical boxes that the vehicle would be sitting on that would create this vehicle to be unsafe for us and the passenger. He's then gonna place the step chock on the passenger side underneath the A-post and another 4x4 cribbing in front of that rear wheel. After that, completing his 360 to make sure there's no additional hazards on the backside, that would determine that the vehicle is safe and secured for our extrication evolution. The next step is to gain access to the 12-volt battery system and shut that down. One of the issues that occurs out there is we get tunnel vision and sidetracked. We come right directly to the latching system where we try to gain access to pop the hood. The problem is it's reinforced for front-end collisions, and when the impact is made, it makes this area very difficult to find that locking mechanism and actually get the hood to unlatch. The other thing we do is we take the halligan and we'll slam it into the front of this hood in either of the two corners. When we do that, we're looking to pry it up, creating a purchase point in here where we believe the battery is going to be located, here or here. The problem is this headlight is actually designed to go all the way back about this far and over. And that's because they're making deeper headlights with HID and other various types of lighting systems that create it to be more of an electronic component. And we never actually gain access to that battery system. So with those two things really not being a possibility, we have an alternate way to get into this hood, which is very smooth, fast, and efficient to get to the 12-volt battery.
Watching my vitals on drum, my battle lines going to war again. Feeling the rhythm inside of my chest, all I need is just a pen. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this. Don't care for the critics, my words and life is a force that they can't stop. They just don't get it, I think they forget I'm not done till I'm on top. I know I was born for this. I know I was born for this.
So now that we've gained access to the engine compartment, we've located the battery, we need to talk about de-energizing this vehicle. In the past, we've been a little lax about de-energizing vehicles when we're just popping doors and stuff like that. But with the increasing the amount of airbags and the directions they come from and the power of those airbags in newer vehicles, we really need to start doing a better job of this. Now, that doesn't mean you immediately get on scene, pull a pair of side cutters out, start cutting battery terminal cables. It could be something as simple as grabbing a wrench out of your pocket, loosening the nuts or turn or two, and pulling the cables off the battery terminals. As long as you tuck those away enough to where they don't return back with the wire memory, you've effectively de-energized this vehicle. The reason for that is if you need to manipulate the seat or any of the electronic components in the vehicle to extricate the patient, the medic inside or someone that can reach it can do that before you de-energize the car, because you don't want to re-energize the car after it's been de-energized. The second option is obviously a pair of side cutters. We're gonna cut these battery cables. If we have a critical patient, we need to get them out right now. We don't care about how much damage we do to this car. We just need to get to that patient. And there is an order of operations to do that and a couple different tips to keep in mind while you're doing that. We're gonna go over that right now. So now that you found your battery, the first thing you need to do is identify the positive battery terminal and the negative battery terminal. The negative battery terminal sends the energy out to the electronic components of the car, and then it returns through the positive battery terminal. The positive battery terminal is always identified by either a red cable or a plus sign beside the battery terminal, or both. We want to cut the negative battery terminal cable first, because that cuts the energy off to the car immediately. Then we can go back and cut the positive terminal cable, and that also eliminates some sparks when we make this cut. When we make this cut on the negative battery terminal, we want to make sure we cut it twice and leave a gap of at least a couple inches when we make the cut. That again keeps those wire memories from returning and re-energizing the car while we're extricating the patient.
Don't ever lose your hope, just know you were born for this. Just know you were born for this. We are the warriors.
In the past, if we saw the airbag deployed from the steering wheel, we'd think we were great. We didn't need to worry about airbags anymore. We could climb in and deal with the patient. Well, that's changed. They now have airbags down by the knees so that the driver does not submarine down in below. They have them in the center console. In the center console, it'll come up and make it kind of like a cocoon for the patient inside their bird cage. They're pretty much everywhere now in the newer cars, and we need to be cognizant of that. That's why it's important that we cut the battery cables when we do. So to backtrack and bring it all full circle, make sure the battery cables are cut before you start moving in and around the cab and trying to extricate the patient, because those bags are gonna come at you from areas that you're not expecting it with the new vehicles. That's all I got. I'm Josh Dahl, Take care.
After we've secured the 12-volt battery, another important thing to do as a ladder company is to come in and assess for additional airbags inside the vehicle before we start making our cuts. That would be removal of the trim, because that's usually where the airbags are going to be located. For example, this is our A-post. As I reach my finger in, I simply pull this away. There's clips here, and it pops right off. I move that out of the way, and what I'm looking for is airbags. And not just the airbag, I'm looking for the airbag cylinder. We can cut through an airbag all day long, but it's when we compress an air cylinder with the cutters is when that can turn into an explosive. So you can also cut through these cylinders with a Sawzall because you're releasing the gas at a very slow rate, but when you use the cutters, it's actually compressing the cylinder, which makes it like an explosive. So we need to keep in mind of that, but also the best thing is just to stay away from it. There's also airbags up the A post over towards the B post. And so removing of this plastic here to take a look from that angle, you may not see it. I don't need to remove this whole plastic, but I can look down the B post by pulling this away from it and see that there's no airbag cylinders. Now, if I am the ladder company, or I'm an engine company guy, I've already assessed this and I can let the ladder company know, hey, it's safe to cut here. We also need to assess on the top of the roof. Now, when you're in these scenarios, we're not asking for you to rip the whole vehicle apart. We're only asking for you to search where the cuts are gonna be made, because you could spend hours inside this vehicle trying to find all the airbags, especially when you get into a Tesla or a high-end brand new vehicle.
So there's a lot to be done in the first minute or so on scene of a pin job, and there's countless ways to accomplish those tasks. The critical ones, though, we've talked about today, we got to stabilize that vehicle as best we can. We got to make sure we complete a 360 and identify any dangers or complications that may slow our extrication efforts or make them completely unsafe. We got to make sure we gain access to the engine compartment and de-energize that vehicle. And then lastly, we got to pull the trim in and around areas that we're going to be cutting or spreading in the cabin of the vehicle. It's important to realize that we can't make these vehicles completely safe. We don't work in a sterile environment, and there is some inherent danger to this job. But by completing these tasks before we start an auto extrication, we can greatly reduce the chances of us being hurt or us further injuring our patient.
That they can't stop. They just don't get it. I think they forget I'm not done till I'm on top. I know.